Greetings, Hassan. You have asked an excellent question. Why do Christians seem to sin freely? I would like to explain the Bible's position about sin, brother, and then I can discuss the answer with more clarity for you. Let's begin with something fundamental, the definition of sin. The message of the prophets is that sin is committing some act which God has forbidden. The prophets often said that sins were sins against God. Psalm 51:4, "Against you, you only, God, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. As a result, you are just in your pronouncement and clear in your judgment." This following verse is Joseph speaking. He is rejecting the temptation to have sex with Potiphar's wife. Genesis 39:9, "There is none greater in this house than I. Neither has he kept back anything from me but thee, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" You might think adultery is a sin against the other man, but here Joseph clearly calls it a sin against God. Deuteronomy 20:17, "But you shall utterly destroy them, namely the Hittites and the Amorites, the Canaanites and the Perizzites, the Hivites and the Jebusites, as the Lord thy God has commanded thee. So they won't teach you to do all the detestable things that they do for their gods. If you do what they teach you, you will sin against Jehovah your God." Hassan, following pagan teachings will cause a person to sin against Jehovah, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I am sure that you do not want to follow pagan teachings, brother. The prophets also teach that sin can be committed against other men. 1 Samuel 2:25, "If someone sins against a man, God will mediate for him. But if someone sins against the Lord, who can intercede for him?" Hassan, the prophets of the Bible also teach that all men and women commit sin. We cannot help it. Isaiah 59:2, "But your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear." Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Hassan, it is this state of mankind being sinful, which God knew would happen before he created mankind. This is why God revealed himself through the prophets as the Redeemer of mankind. Psalm 130 verse 8, "He himself will redeem Israel from every kind of sin." That verse, revealed by Prophet David, very clearly says Israel. Right, Hassan? And God will still fulfill his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, because God is not a man that he should lie. Isaiah 47:4, "Our Redeemer, Jehovah of hosts, is his name, the Holy One of Israel." Job 19:25, "For I know that my Redeemer lives, and at the last day he will stand upon the earth." Isaiah 59:20, "And the Redeemer shall come to Zion, and unto them that turn from transgression in Jacob, saith the Lord." Hassan, I'm sorry to briefly change the subject, but I want you to understand this verse clearly. Isaiah 59:20, "And the Redeemer shall come to Zion, and unto them that turn from transgression in Jacob, saith the Lord." Notice this is the Lord God talking here, brother. Notice that God speaks indirectly of the Redeemer, saying the Redeemer. And God, speaking through prophet Isaiah, says the Redeemer shall come to Zion. This verse clearly speaks of the Lord Jesus, brother, coming as the Redeemer whom God sends. Hassan, I'm sorry I have not yet gotten to your question. But I think, brother, that you first need to understand what the prophets said about sin. And you need to know what God planned to do about the situation of sin. Isaiah 63:16, "For you are our father, though Abraham does not know us and Israel does not recognize us. You, O Lord, are our father, our redeemer from of old is your name." Isaiah 43:14, "Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, for your sake I send to Babylon and bring them all down as fugitives, even the Chaldeans in the ships in which they rejoice." Over and over, brother, God is called the Redeemer by the prophets, especially Isaiah. And in the New Testament, brother, God clarifies who that Redeemer is. The Redeemer is the one who redeemed mankind. Galatians 3:13, "Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, because it is written, everyone who is hung on a tree is cursed." Galatians 3:14, "The purpose was that the blessing of Abraham would come on the Gentiles by Christ Jesus, so that we could receive the promised Spirit through faith." Luke 1:68, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them." So, Hassan, the first thing to understand is that God knew men would sin, and God planned to redeem them. And fulfilling his plan, God did redeem us. The issue at the heart of your question, Hassan, is why do Christians still sin? And that question is related to an accusation by Islam that you have learned. The accusation is, Christians sin because forgiveness is treated as a license to sin. But the Bible teaches about this and speaks directly to this incorrect thinking. Romans 6:1, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid! How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein?" The NIV says, "By no means." New Living says, "Of course not." The New American Standard, "May it never be." The Holman, "Absolutely not." The God's Word Translation, "That's unthinkable." You see, Hassan, the teaching by Jesus in the Bible tells us that a true Christian is one who has been born again. The new birth spoken of by the phrase born again means to be born by the Spirit of God. Ephesians 2:1, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins." Brother, the Word of God teaches that being sinful is like being dead. Ephesians 2:4, "But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved." Hassan, this is the difference between the God of the Bible and the Allah of the Quran. The God of the Bible is great and able to love even sinners. Your Allah cannot. And Apostle Paul, who learned from Jesus after Jesus was resurrected, taught, "For the law of the life-giving Spirit in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death." He also taught about what Christians must do with their bodies. Romans 6:13, "Stop offering the parts of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness. Instead, offer yourselves to God as people who have been brought from death to life, and the parts of your body as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin will not have mastery over you, because you are not under law, but under grace." What then? Shall we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? May it never be. This is directly asking and then answering your question, brother. Truly, God knows all, brother, and God has written the answer. Do you not know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves for obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin resulting in death, or of obedience resulting in righteousness? The answer, Hassan, is that Christians are required to submit our bodies to God in obedience. Christians are commanded to not sin because to sin is to become the slave to sin and follow a path to death. In fact, brother, God has a very sober message for those who, being Christians, turn away from the gospel and enter into sin. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 4, "For it is impossible to bring back to repentance those who were once enlightened, those who have experienced the good things of heaven and shared in the Holy Spirit, and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come, and then have fallen away. It is impossible to renew them again to repentance, since they again crucify to themselves the Son of God and put him to open shame." This is a very scary statement to me, Hassan. No Christian should continue in sin. Hebrews 10:29. Just think how much worse the punishment will be for those who have trampled on the Son of God and have treated the blood of the covenant which made us holy as if it were common and unholy, and have insulted and disdained the Holy Spirit who brings God's mercy to us. Just think, Hassan, if the message of Jesus is correct and Jesus was the Son of God, continuing to sin shows God great contempt. It is like stomping on God's Son with your shoe. So, brother, the idea of a true Christian intentionally sinning just because they think they will be forgiven makes no sense. Let me give you one more example, brother Hassan. If you knew that for each sin or crime you committed, your mother or father or brother would receive a stroke of a cane, maybe even a worse penalty, would you laugh and sin more because you thought you would be forgiven and you would escape punishment? Would you sin more once you knew they would be the one who was whipped more? Well, the Bible teaches that Jesus suffered the pain of the judgment for our sin. And if you understand that and let it sink in, you could imagine that each sin you commit is an injury which Christ endured for you. How do you think any person could claim to love God and love his Son and then sin more, inflicting more suffering on the Son of God? This is what Islam begs you to believe about Christians, brother. Islam begs you to believe that Christians would laugh and sin while a loved one was whipped and tortured for our sins. And then, Hassan, Islam tells you, just get them to say Shahada and reject Christianity, deny the Son of God, and Allah, supposedly the same God, will forgive them? Hassan, Islam has taught you some very twisted and foolish ideas. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.